Hey there! Today I'm here to talk to you about maps, and then we'll work on drawing our own maps together. I love maps. I collect them everywhere I go, whether they're transit maps, trail maps, or even museum maps. Maps hold an immense amount of information. Imagine if you had to describe an area entirely with words. It would take forever, and depending on the area that you're describing, it could be really confusing.
Yeah, so there's this road called Crescent Road, and it's called that because it's shaped like a crescent, and at one end it kind of loops around and goes back in the same direction, but it changes to Ridge Road, so it has a different name. Oh, and coming out from the downtown area, there are these roads that sort of, like, intersect with Crescent and Ridge. Oh, you're walking? Then never mind. You can't walk along the roads. All the sidewalks are internal.
So here's a map of the area I was just describing. Here are Crescent and Ridge and the roads that come out like spokes. Much better, right? We can even use maps to describe fictional places, or things that aren't places at all, like our thoughts and our ideas. Today, however, we'll be focusing on maps that depict places, real or fictional, as small as a cell, or as large as our solar system. There's a lot that goes into making a map. There's the scale, the key, a compass, symbols, labels, and all the different information that a map includes. So where do you start? I believe the most important part of a map is its purpose. Whether your map has a very specific purpose, like hiking through a particular national park, or is more for general reference, like a world map that you might find in a classroom. You would probably only use the trail map when you're hiking in the park, while a teacher might use the world map for all sorts of different subjects. Once you know the purpose of your map, it's much easier to make decisions about what information to include. For example, if the purpose of a museum map is to help visitors navigate the exhibits, including the locations of staff offices probably isn't necessary. Now that we know where to start, let's get to work on our own maps. If you'd like, you're welcome to use this template, but you can also simply follow along using any paper you'd like. Have you come up with any ideas for your map yet? I think it's helpful to start with one of these verbs: find, navigate, study, document, or teach. Remember, your map can be of anything you want. It could be of your neighborhood, your room, the setting of your favorite book, your fridge, or even your hamster cage. So, I have this problem where every spring I forget what's growing in my garden and where it's planted. So I wind up accidentally pulling up plants that I want to keep or planting things way too close. That's why I'm going to create a map that documents where the plants are in my garden. Next, we'll decide on the extent of our maps. The extent of a map is the area that it shows, and that area must be scaled to the size of your map. Of course, the larger the area in your map, the less detail it'll have. For example, a map of North America wouldn't be very useful for documenting my garden. Why? Well, you can't even see my neighborhood on a map of North America, let alone the plants in my garden. So, the extent of my map will be my yard. Scale describes the size that real-life objects appear on a map. We often see scale written as a ratio, like 1 inch equals 10 feet. Your scale could also be descriptive, like 1 square equals 1 city block. Remember, the accuracy of your scale depends on your map's purpose. An architectural drawing needs to be extremely accurate, whereas a map showing your friends how to get from their house to yours probably doesn't need to be that accurate. We'll revisit scale when we start drawing our maps. Finally, we need to decide on what information our map should include, like points of interest, boundaries, physical features, and even statistics. I want my map to include surfaces, like grass, pavement, and mulch, and of course trees, shrubs, and perennials. Alright, now that our map is all planned out, let's start putting it down on paper. Go ahead and start drawing your map. Alright, I'm just about finished drawing my map, but we're not done yet. There's some information that we need to include with our maps to help users decide if it's suitable for their purposes and help them interpret it. Let's start with the title. The titles in a newspaper tell you what the article is all about, so you can decide whether or not you want to read it. Map titles are no different. A good, descriptive title will help someone decide whether or not they want to use your map. The title of my map is going to be Heather's Garden. Next, you'll want to add your name. When you draw a map, it captures your unique perspective. So let people know who created it. And finally, add the date. Maps capture a particular moment in time. For example, my map was drawn in May 2020. Next May, my yard could look completely different. Now let's add the information that helps people interpret your map. That means adding your scale, key, and a compass. The squares on my map represent an area about 2 feet across, or 24 inches. The key shows the patterns that I used for grass, mulch, pavement, perennials, shrubs, and trees. Finally, we need to add our compass. The compass helps users orient themselves and understand how your map fits into the rest of the world. Usually, they're labeled using cardinal directions, north, west, south, and east. But, say if you're mapping your fridge, you might want to use ceiling, floor, wall, stove. Just choose whatever works best for you. If you really enjoyed this activity, I also recommend checking out the Globe Observer app. Globe Observer is a citizen science project that allows you to go out and take observations of different environmental conditions using your cell phone. And then you can view your observations along with everyone else's on a world map. So thank you all so much for joining me to learn more about maps today. I cannot wait to see the maps that you've been working on, so be sure to share them with us.